Well, good morning, and welcome to this week's online worship from the parishes of North Dartmoor, and our celebration of the presentation of Christ, or Candlemas. This is a time of transition, both in the Christian calendar, as we leave behind the seasons of Christmas and Epiphany, and start the journey towards Holy Week and Easter, and also in the natural world, as the days lengthen and winter begins to give way to spring. The emergence of the first snowdrops at this time of year gives us all a lift with their promise of brighter things to come. There's something really special about snowdrops, whether they're in the garden, at the side of the road, or carpeting the woodland floor. That flash of luminous white speaks of spring and renewal, of hope rekindled. Each individual flower seems so delicate, as though it would crumple in the face of the winter gales. And yet they appear long before we feel the grip of winter relaxing, defiantly pushing through the snow and frost, with confident faith that belies their fragile frame. In the harshness of winter, they bob in the wind like flickering candles. The botanical name for the snowdrop, galanthus, is derived from two Greek words, meaning milk flower. And those images of light, purity, sustenance and intricate beauty have long linked the snowdrop to the feast of the presentation of Christ, which actually falls on the 2nd of February, but which we celebrate today. For this reason, the snowdrop was once known as the Candlemas bell, and back in medieval times, it was common practice to bring snowdrops into the church for this festival. And so we begin our worship this morning with a prayer for Candlemas, from the community of Aidan and Hilda. We thank you, source of all created light, that you sent your Son to shine among us with eternal light. In our darkness, we light a candle of hope. As the season of darkness recedes, may the incoming light be to us the true light, in whose presence no unworthy thought, no deed of shame, may stubbornly remain. Our opening hymn this morning recalls the faithful waiting of Simeon and Anna in the temple. Come, thou long-expected Jesus. In a time of quiet reflection, we turn back to God, our loving Heavenly Father, to say sorry for the times when we've let him down, and to receive his forgiveness. All of us carry with us past experiences, past failures or mistakes, which lie like burdens on our lives. All of us have histories in our relationships, things that we wish we had not said or done, or which should have happened but never did. In the silence, let us reflect on the burdens we no longer wish to carry. Take all these burdens from us, O God. We lay them down in faith for healing, forgiveness, recreation and release. Hear the word of God for us. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they break from the bud, I announce them to you. Rise up and live in hope. We are forgiven. Grace is ours this day. Amen.
Malachi, chapter 3. See, I will send my messenger, who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in days gone by, as in former years. So I will come near to you for judgment. I will be quick to testify against sorcerers, adulterers, and perjurers, against those who defraud labourers of their wages, who oppress the widows and the fatherless, and deprive aliens of justice, but do not fear me, says the Lord Almighty. Amen.
A reading from St. Luke's Gospel. Jesus is presented in the temple. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, Mary and Joseph brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel. And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favour of God was upon him.
I don't know about you, but I enjoy reading. And I particularly enjoy biographies and autobiographies of political leaders. I think it's because I'm inquisitive and I like to know what's going on behind the scenes. So I was particularly pleased at Christmas to receive a copy of Barack Obama's new book, Promised Land. It's fascinating thinking about these leaders' early experiences of life and the events that shaped them. Some years ago, I read a really riveting biography. It started at the very beginning with the birth of this particular leader. He was born in humble circumstances, destined for greatness and destined for suffering. He was born on the 12th of February, 1809, in a one-room log cabin with a dirt floor on a farm in Kentucky in America. He grew up to be a great man. He loved reading and he devoured books. And despite having only 1 year of formal education, he succeeded in becoming a lawyer. He was determined to make a difference, and so he entered the world of politics. And he believed that to have maximum effect, he needed to become president of the United States. He tried and tried over many years. He encountered many personal, professional, and political setbacks. He knew defeat, he knew humiliation, and he knew a measure of success. Finally, in 1860, he was elected President of the United States of America, only to be assassinated 5 years into his presidency. He presided over the abolition of slavery and the end of the Civil War. You may have guessed that I'm speaking about Abraham Lincoln, whom some regard as the greatest of all American presidents. Through patient hope and great determination, he became the 16th president of the United States. I have been avidly following the election of the 46th president. President Biden also came from humble beginnings. He also suffered many personal, professional, and political setbacks. He has known defeat and success. With patient hope and great determination, he's got there in the end. His motto is, "There's always hope. There's always hope." At the age of 78, he is the oldest American president ever. Our own Prime Minister described his presidency as a moment of hope in dark times. So there's Lincoln and Biden, both men of prayer, both full of hope. Our passage from Luke chapter 2 tells of another future leader, also born in humble circumstances, also destined for greatness, also destined for suffering, a moment of hope in dark times. Now, there would be no account of this important occasion of the presentation of Christ in the temple if it were not for the obedience of the main characters. There would be no account without Simeon and Anna. If they had not been single-minded, faithful, devout worshippers of God, sensitive to the guidance of the Holy Spirit, they would not have been in the right place at the right time, meeting the right people. Divinely inspired, they were guided by the Holy Spirit to the temple in Jerusalem, the temple of Herod, a massive, awe-inspiring building. Three times in this passage, Luke mentions the Holy Spirit. In obedience to the prompting of the Spirit, this brief encounter by divine appointment takes place in fulfillment of God's redemptive plan. A reminder, perhaps, for us that through the practice of daily prayer, we also can become sensitive to the prompting and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Now, of course, there would be no account of the presentation of Christ in the temple if it hadn't been for Joseph and Mary, if they hadn't been equally single-minded, faithful, devout worshippers of God. If they had not been obedient to the law of Moses, they would not have been in the right place at the right time, meeting the right people. Divinely inspired, they were guided by the Mosaic law to go to the temple in Jerusalem. Three times Luke mentions their obedience to the law written in the Old Testament, in Leviticus and Exodus, where women were regarded as ceremonially unclean for 40 days after the birth of the son. The law required a sacrifice be offered in the temple for purification. The law also required that the firstborn son be presented in the temple so that the boy could be consecrated to the service of God. In obedience to the law, this brief encounter by divine appointment takes place in fulfillment of God's redemptive plan. A reminder, perhaps, for us that through the practice of daily scripture reading, we also can begin to grasp more clearly God's plan and purpose for our lives. Obedience to law and the Spirit led to this brief encounter that is imbued with so much significance. In this passage from Luke, we read of four main characters and a baby. The spotlight is on the baby, as it usually is when a firstborn is present among adoring family and friends. The infant Jesus is the centre of attention. He does nothing, and yet everything revolves around him. Simeon and Anna testify to his arrival as the saviour of the world. Faith is vindicated, hope is realised. The baby will bring light to the world, salvation to all. Simeon and Anna lived in patient hope. They were both people of prayer, praying for the salvation of God's people. They recognized the baby that they met in the temple as the answer to their prayers. Of course, they had to wait until old age to see the salvation that they longed for. These two elderly witnesses testify to the central place of Jesus in God's redemptive plan, a moment of hope in dark times. Judaism required two witnesses in law, and here we have two, one male, one female, both elderly. In a society where elderly people were revered and honoured, to say a witness was old was to imply that the witness was credible. How different our attitude to the elderly today. Many would assume that the elderly would be less credible witnesses. I wonder if you are familiar with Anna chaplaincy. It's named after this elderly widow, Anna, who greets the infant Jesus in the temple. Today, Anna chaplains support older people emotionally and spiritually, offering valuable spiritual care to those in later life. Simeon and Anna are great examples of faithful, prayerful older people who lived a long life and experienced so much, and who continue to be faithful, giving and receiving God's grace. Older age does not mean the scrap heap, thankfully. So as prayer and praise in the temple give way to prophecy, a dark and forbidding cloud descends as Simeon speaks of provocation and pain. Jesus will provoke opposition. Many will be hostile to him and to his message. There will be division, revealing the hearts of those who will serve him and those who will oppose him. One writer put it like this. He said, the appearance of the incarnate Son of God is like a catalyst in a chemical solution. In other words, there will be a reaction. Simeon speaks dark words, predicting suffering as part of his proclamation. Mary will not be spared. The sword, he says, will pierce her heart. By divine appointment and during this brief encounter, Simeon and Anna receive and proclaim Jesus, the Saviour of the world. God's plan of salvation embraces all of humanity. It brings hope to a world that desperately needs it, now more than ever. I want to close with a prayer of St. Benedict that I particularly like, a prayer that we might develop some of the qualities and the spiritual gifts that we see in the lives of people like Anna and Simeon. Gracious and Holy Father, give us wisdom to perceive you, diligence to seek you, patience to wait for you, eyes to behold you, a heart to meditate upon you, and a life to proclaim you, through the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Candlemas by Jan Such Picard. In the dark days, under rain-heavy clouds, among broken branches, on sodden earth, the snowdrops light their candles, a flame that cannot be put out by darkness or gales or doubt. In the salt wind, rocks buckle like broken umbrellas. As the bare trees heave a great sigh, the snowdrops tremble, but their flame cannot be put out by darkness or gales or doubt. Perfect as though carved in green-veined marble, life pulsing through tissue, delicate as the eyelids of a sleeping child, curved like small fingers holding on. Their flame is steadfast. It is full of hope and new beginnings. Darkness or gales or doubt cannot put it out.
Let us pray to the Father, through Jesus Christ, who is our light and life. Faithful God, we thank you for the example of Simeon and Anna, for their faithful service and witness, and their patient waiting for Christ to be revealed. Help us to serve you as they did, faithfully and patiently, watching for you to be revealed in our own lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, we give you thanks for all the older people in our communities. Send your Holy Spirit to inspire us all to use and share our life experiences with wisdom, humility, and gladness, and to be willing to listen and learn from those older than ourselves. We pray especially for the work of the Anna chaplains as they seek to minister to people in later life, in residential homes, in their own homes, and to their relatives and carers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we pray for all who work for peace and unity, and for all world leaders, that they will continue to seek an end to the suffering caused by violence, injustice, disease, poverty, and hopelessness, and bring healing to the world. Help each one of us to fight against evil with love, wherever we are, so that we might be like candles in the darkness of despair. Lord, give us the eyes of faith to see your presence in the world. Where fear closes our eyes, help us. Where tears blind us, heal us. Where busyness keeps us from noticing, slow us. Where pride gets in the way, release us. Set us free to see your love at work in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we pray for all finding their life painful, lonely, or uncertain, especially those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. Help them to sense your comfort in times of need, and bless their families and carers. Be with all those affected by the COVID pandemic in any way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Lord, your love reaches beyond the grave. At the end of our days on earth, be with us and with those we love. May those who have gone before us rest in your eternal peace. We remember before you those who have died, and we pray for all whose life is saddened by the death of a loved one. Be with them in their loneliness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Everlasting God, we pray for ourselves. As we start the week ahead, we ask that in all we do, we may walk more closely with you at our side, safe in the knowledge that your fatherly love and care knows no bounds. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We conclude our prayers with the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
Come to the end of our time together. I hope you've enjoyed sharing in our worship this morning. We close with a final prayer of blessing, inspired by Bridget of Kildare, the Celtic saint whose feast day is celebrated on Tuesday. May God our Father, our strength and our light, bless us with what we most need, beyond even all that we would ask. For the weather is always right for the sowing of good seed. Amen. Well, we hope you'll be able to join us again next week. But for now, take care and have a good week as we travel on in the light of Christ.